The Renaissance, which lasted from 1300 to 1600, was a period marked by the revival of learning about ancient Greece and Rome, and so was aptly named. The word Renaissance even means rebirth. It was a time when art, philosophy, music, and radical thought all abounded. The whole world was turning its eye to beauty, as inventions like the printing press and telescope proved to be revolutionary. But in the late 1400s, the music stopped for a time. A new disease, sometimes called the Grande Virule, or Great Pox by the French, what we now call syphilis, was a malady the likes of which Italians or the later world had never seen, and more importantly, had no immunity toward. What started as genital ulcers led to fever, a rash, and body aches. Months later, painful and foul-smelling sores began appearing on people's bodies, and green acorn-like boils protruded from their skin. Their bodies were covered in scabs and swollen with tubercles, which started off as bright red and then progressed into a repulsive black color. Sores became ulcers that ate into their bones, destroying their noses, lips, and eyes, sometimes extending to the throat. The flesh falling off the sufferers' faces made them unrecognizable. What we in modern times treat as and understand to be a fairly benign sexually transmitted disease caused a deadly epidemic in the middle of the Renaissance that killed up to 5 million people. Evidence, which includes reports from scholars at the time and woodcut drawings, indicate that this syphilis was more virulent than what we see today, a much more contagious, deadly strain that killed people at a quicker rate. And while the virus that is causing today's coronavirus pandemic and the one that caused the syphilis epidemic aren't related, it seems likely that now more than ever the entire world can empathize with that fear of the unknown that people in the Renaissance faced, just as we do today. And perhaps we can even learn something from how humanity dealt with the epidemic in the past. German humanist Josef Grünpeck, who eventually fell prey to the syphilis outbreak, called it so cruel, so distressing, so appalling, that until now nothing more terrible or disgusting has ever been known on this earth. And Albrecht Dürer, who later etched artistic woodcut portrayals of sufferers, wrote, "God save me from the French disease. I know nothing of which I am so afraid. Nearly every man has it, and it eats up so many that they die." Syphilis didn't have a proper name when it struck, and because it was the first disease to be discovered after the printing press was invented, news of it was spreading almost as quickly as the disease itself. It was also the first sexually transmitted disease to be recognized as such, making it one of the first times morality around sex and its implications had ever been brought into the discussion surrounding disease. The trajectory of its spread across Europe and then globally looked like this. By late 1495, it had spread throughout France, Switzerland, and Germany, and reached England and Scotland in 1497, according to the Journal of Military and Veterans Health. Scandinavia, Britain, Hungary, Greece, Poland, and Russia were all hit by 1500. Just 20 years later, it expanded its global grip and touched Africa, China, Japan, and Oceania. Syphilis, for the most part, is not a death sentence in contemporary times. Thankfully, its rate of spreading looks nothing like what Italy saw at the end of the 15th century, and it doesn't turn people into zombies anymore. While transmitted through sexual contact, it's also spread skin to skin through contact with the sores it causes. It has three phases. Primary syphilis. The first of these is when a single sore or a canker will appear, usually about 3 weeks after an initial infection. Secondary syphilis occurs 2 to 8 weeks after the primary phase, when a non-itchy rash might appear, coupled with coarse reddish-brown spots on the soles of the feet and on the palms of the hands. In some cases, though, the rash can be so subtle that it goes completely unnoticed. The secondary phase could also be accompanied by fever and swollen lymphs, along with other flu-like symptoms. If left untreated, the last stage of syphilis, or the tertiary stage, is also the most dangerous. Maybe the most terrifying part of it, though, is that it could strike 10 to 20 years later. About 15 to 30% of those infected with syphilis reach this stage, which can wreak havoc on the brain, nerves, eyes, heart, blood vessels, liver, bones, and joints. Today, early treatment usually involves the use of antibiotics, often one injection of penicillin G. But if it's in its very latent stages, 3 doses of the shot are given in weekly intervals. While it's not possible to repair damage that's already been done by the infection, the medicine will usually stop it in its tracks. It wasn't until 1943 that penicillin was discovered to be an effective treatment for syphilis, so much too late for the 15th century Italians, but more on that later. It's been over 500 years since the outbreak in Italy, and its origin is still being debated. Up until the early 1900s, scholars had thought it had been brought from the New World to the Old by Christopher Columbus in his travels in 1493. That was disputed in 1934 when a new hypothesis put forward claimed syphilis existed in Europe even before Columbus. This is also supported by the writings of Hippocrates, where it seemed like he was describing the symptoms of syphilis in its tertiary form. And then, some more recent studies have reverted back to the original idea that Columbus was in fact responsible for bringing it over. So, as you can see, nobody really has gotten to the bottom of this. John Parscandola, author of Sex, Science, and Sin: A History of Syphilis in America, noted in an Atlantic article, though, that most physicians agreed it was a new disease that hadn't been seen in Europe. One theory is that it all started when 50,000 French troops who were under the command of King Charles VIII invaded Italy in August 1494. Charles wanted to take over Naples in the hopes that he could use it as a staging point to launch a crusade, and his troops might have brought the STD with them on their campaign to prepare for a holy war. Findings by a team from Emory University in 2008 support the idea that it might have also been possible that Columbus and his men brought along with them a non-venereal strain of the infection that would eventually evolve into the pathogen we're familiar with today after it was introduced into the Old World. Naples was a place with a lot of brothels, so as the soldiers were fraternizing with the prostitutes and city dwellers, the deadly spiral of contagion might have begun when they infected the prostitutes, who passed it on to the next client, and the next client, and the next client. Well, you get the picture. Adding to the unfortunate vicious cycle of infection, women and wet nurses could also transmit it to babies while nursing. University scholars at the time of the outbreak desperately tried to get to the bottom of how it was spreading, eventually catching on that it was primarily spread sexually. Although this didn't stop other outlandish ideas from arising, some blaming the alignment of the planets, that it might have originated from the boils of Job, or that this might all be the punishment of an angry god who was disgusted by fornication. One of these believers was Maximilian I, Rome's holy emperor in 1495, who thought syphilis must have been God's punishment for blasphemy. An international blame game soon arose, with everyone pointing the finger at nations they believed were at fault. The French thought Italy was most likely responsible, so they called it the Neapolitan disease, or the disease of Naples, or, clearly having a hard time deciding who the real culprit was, the Spanish disease. The English and Italians both blamed France, so they referred to it as the French disease, the Gallic disease, or Morbus Gallicus. The Turkish called it the Christian disease, the Tahitians called it the British disease, in India it was called the Portuguese disease, in Japan it was called the Chinese pox, and then some just called it the Persian fire, which we'd say is probably the strangest of all. The name syphilis comes from the Latin poem Syphilis Sive Morbus Gallicus by Girolamo Francastoro, which was published in 1530, and translates to syphilis, the French disease. In it, the protagonist, a shepherd named Syphilis, enrages the sun god and is punished with the disease. The verses where the name comes from go like this: "A shepherd once, distrust not ancient fame, possesses these downs, and Syphilis his name. He first wore bubos dreadful to the sight, first felt strange pains and sleepless passed the night. From him the malady received its name, the neighboring shepherds catched the spreading flame. They tried treating syphilitic patients using mercury and mercury ointments, which really only made their conditions worse, many of them dying from mercury poisoning. Mercury treatments had the side effects of severe nerve damage, kidney failure, mouth ulcers, and loss of teeth. To help you imagine what the heinous mercury treatment was like, S.V. Beck, the author of Syphilis the Great Pox, described it like this: a patient undergoing the treatment was secluded in a hot, stuffy room and rubbed vigorously with the mercury ointment several times a day. The massaging was done near a hot fire, which the sufferer was then left next to in order to sweat. This process went on for a week or a month or more, and would later be repeated if the disease persisted. Other toxic substances, such as vitriol and arsenic, were also employed, but their curative effects were equally in doubt. Some other early treatments included bloodletting, or the removal of blood in order to treat the disease, which had also historically been used to treat smallpox, the bubonic plague, and epilepsy. Laxatives and baths in wine and herbs or olive oil were also used. Some healers also mistakenly thought sweat baths would help rid the body of the syphilis-related toxicities. Aside from their attempts to treat patients, there were also measures local governments took, like the Edinburgh Town Council that mandated their brothels to close. By the 16th century, guaiacum, also known as holywood, was considered a treatment. Coming from the Dominican Republic, it ended up becoming the first drug administered to treat syphilis in Europe. It was soon lauded by doctors and people like Ulrich von Hutten, a German scholar who suffered from the disease during the last 15 years of his life and eventually died from. Guaiacum treatments came in the form of ointments and potions, but perhaps the most vile was as an enema, which provoked diarrhea. Then the patient was supposed to sit and sweat in a hot room for 40 days and then fast. We don't need to tell you that this didn't work, but the healers at the time continued to swear by it. 21 tons of guaiacum reached Seville between 1568 and 1608, with the import finally tapering off in the 18th century. Fast forward to 1928, the year when Alexander Fleming, a Scottish scientist, discovered that one of his uncovered petri dishes close to an open window had become contaminated with mold, and his curiosity was piqued when he realized that the bacteria near this mold were dying. Isolating the mold that was responsible for this, he named it Penicillium genus, and discovered it fought all gram-positive pathogens, or the nasty ones responsible for diphtheria, an infection of the nose and throat, gonorrhea, meningitis, pneumonia, and scarlet fever. He also later found that it was not just the mold itself, but a juice that it had produced that destroyed the bacteria. This mold juice became penicillin. And then, as it so often does, history repeated itself. Soldiers during World War II began to experience a rash of venereal diseases, pun definitely intended. Nearly 5% of draftees in 1942 had syphilis, according to a medical paper published in the journal Military Medicine. Penicillin proved to still be effective when doctors at a U.S. Marine hospital on Staten Island in New York gave it to 4 patients who were in the early stages of the disease, curing them of it. The following year, doctors published a study on how effective penicillin injections were when they were given every few hours for 8 days, according to Business Insider. Syphilis saw a resurgence again in 2014, when the CDC reported that there were close to 20,000 cases, which weren't as bad as the record high number seen in the 1990s, but still concerning. As a result, the U.S. Preventative Services Task Force suggested screening those who were at a higher risk every 3 months. The reason for this rise in cases? Because the disease often goes undetected, sometimes causing no symptoms leading to carriers spreading it without realizing. Maybe it is a bit like the coronavirus after all. Want to hear more about diseases? Check out our video, Is COVID-19 a Modern Black Plague? Or click this other video over here instead.